Please remain standing for our Pledge of Allegiance. Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. And now we will have the singing of the national anthem from the Songbird of the South, Miss Dottie Peoples. The Honorable Judge Barbara Caldwell, Douglas County Magistrate Court, friend of the family, outstanding citizen of our community, wonderful lady, an inspiration to me with our invocation.
Good afternoon again. It is certainly an honor to be invited to share in this beautiful occasion with Ricky. I was told I could say a few words in honor of Ricky. And Ricky, in the words of Shirley Franklin, you make us proud. You make us proud. Not only do you make us proud, you are a wonderful, positive example for our young people to follow. We want you to know we love you and we're proud of you. And I've been knowing you and your family for many, many years. In fact, I think I taught your mother and her, I'm not sure if I taught her your aunt or not, Lisa, but they were instrumental in pushing me over the hill and not letting me teach anymore. So, and I want you to know that as you gain more and more notoriety and you put titles in front of your name and titles behind your name, your family is going to get larger and larger and you're going to need more tickets. You're going to meet people that you never knew were your relatives. And if you dig down deep enough and go back farther enough, you might find out that I'm your Aunt Barbara. Put your hearts and your minds with me, please, and let us bow in a word of prayer. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we come this day We praise you, we magnify you, we glorify you, we lift you up, for truly you are worthy to be praised. We thank you for this young man, Ricky. We thank you for this wonderful and beautiful occasion. We thank you for the gifts that you have given him, because we know that every good and perfect gift comes from you. We thank you for his family, and we ask that you continue to bless him and lift him up and bless his family. We thank you for this wonderful committee who have gotten together and planned this joyous occasion. We thank you, Lord, for everything. We thank you for all the people who have come to pay tribute to this wonderful young man. And Lord, we pray for your guidance. We pray for your leadership. We pray that you will bless this program and that everything that's done and said will be done to your glory, and that everyone here will be edified and encouraged. In the name of Jesus, your darling son, we pray with thanksgiving. Amen. Amen.
Hi, I'm Chan Weeks with Keep Douglasville Beautiful, and my city TV is good for the environment.
What's up? This is my friend Rob from Michigan.
What's up?
He's a teenager.
Yeah.
He's pretty cool.
Woo! Hey, you want to slow down there?
No.
Really? Okay.
What are you doing?
We're shooting a viral video. Hold on, I want to see this. Hey, this is his last 5 minutes on Earth. A little something to Mom? Say something to Mom. How about, goodbye, Mom, sorry.
Thank you for taking part of your Sunday to be here to be part of that assembly that will recognize and honor a terrific young local man, Clarence Ricky Dobbs, Jr. You know, virtually everybody in this room has known Ricky longer than I have. Most of you, I'm sure, could tell a number of stories about Midshipman Dobbs. In fact, I imagine, Ricky, while you and I were doing the 30-minute television program that we finished the final touches on and then did, there were a lot of stories about you being told in here that if you'd known what some of them were, you probably would have been blushing a little bit. But that's part of this occasion, isn't it, to come together so that you can remember this young man as he was growing up and then look to what may lie ahead for him. That, you know, I have an advantage over some of you, though, that the last 2 or 3 days, I've had to spend a good bit of time reading things about Ricky Dobbs, getting ready to do this interview. And so there were some things that I have learned about him that some of you may be catching up on as we go through this afternoon. In fact, we did a 30-minute television program. If I can put in a plug for City TV, that's digital channel 22. You'll be able to see our program in the next few days. And if you don't have a new television, if you don't have a digital adapter, you'll see me or one of our City TV crew after this. We'll tell you how you can get a free adapter, because I know you'll want to watch Ricky in my program at least a couple of times. And you'll probably want to watch what we're doing now to see if you happen to be in the video as it's being shot. But, you know, one of the things that I have learned about Ricky Dobbs as I have prepared for today is that I have a great appreciation and respect for this young man. And today is really a time that we focus on somebody who's living the American dream. And he certainly has achieved a lot, but his future looks very bright. And we're delighted to be a part of this so that he's able to come back, though, to Douglasville, to the north side today, and have you share with him in some of his accomplishments. That, you know, I could give you a number of football statistics concerning his career at Navy, which still has a senior year to go. But as I conclude, I wanted to give you two brief statements that I think tells you about who Ricky Dobbs really is. First of these was when he graduated from Douglas County High School in 2006. He obviously was a very popular student, very gifted athlete, but he also received the faculty cut, which says to me that he had the faculty felt like that he had done a great job being a student there, as well as all of his classmates who appreciated everything that he had done. But the second is at Navy, he has been chosen the vice president of his class at the U.S. Naval Academy. And to me, that tells me that all the other young men and women at the Naval Academy recognize not just his athletic skills, but they also recognize his leadership and his character in making him the vice president of his class at the U.S. Naval Academy. Now, he tells me that his ambitions include a career in the NFL, and when he gets through with that, he plans to be president of the United States. You know, and who knows what the future may be. It may be that one of these days you'll be talking to your children or your grandchildren or even your great-grandchildren, and you'll tell them, you know, back in mid-June of 2010, I was there on the special occasion when we recognized and honored Ricky Dobbs way back when he was just at the U.S. Naval Academy. So it's great to have you here today, and it's great Midshipman Dobbs to have this opportunity to welcome you here to Douglasville, your hometown, and to hear what's going to be said about you this afternoon. Now, it's my pleasure at this time to introduce a lady that I've known for several years. In fact, some years ago, I was the chairman of the Douglasville-Douglas County 96 Welcome Committee concerning the Olympic Games, and she was also an officer on that same committee, Gwen Summers Redwine, and we got well acquainted with each other. In fact, I introduced her recently to be my guest host on my City TV program. And Gwen, if I'd have known I was going to be introducing you, I probably would have brought some of those notes. So I'll just tell you two or three things about Gwen from memory. She is an organizer, and she and her excellent committee have prepared this event this afternoon. But she also is somewhat of a trailblazer herself. From Valdosta, she was part of the integration of the Valdosta school system. She was the first in several different positions, being the first African-American woman in radio, in television, in certain positions, both in Valdosta and in Atlanta, including with the Turner Network a long time ago when it was WTBS, I guess. But Gwen, we appreciate what work you have done on getting ready for this event. And it's my pleasure now to turn the program over to the chairman of this event, Gwen Summers Redwine.
Good afternoon again, everyone. Bill Osborne is the only man I know who can keep me calm under very stressful situations. Thank you very much for that welcome, Bill. But it's not about me, it's about Ricky today. And I'm just so proud to have been asked to chair the committee by his cousin and his mom, Jeanette Reed and mom, Barbara Cobb, came to me and asked if I would do this. And so I quickly assembled a group of very resourceful, intelligent, and creative ladies to make this happen within maybe, 23 days. And I would like for them to stand right now. This is not on the program, but stand now, everybody. On the committee, committee members, please stand. That's Tracy Ivy, hold up your hand. Sandra Jobert, Jeanette Reed, the diva. Diva number one, Elvina Callen. Hold up your hand, Elvina. Helen McCoy, DeVita Walker, Kelly Hunter, the director of City TV. Thank you all so much for your diligence in making this happen. And now we would like to talk to some men who have been quite instrumental in molding and shaping Ricky's life and his integrity, his values, his athleticism throughout his growing years and now. And I would like to start with Coach Charles Thomas.
Favorite moment probably as a youth coach would probably be not necessarily the great plays he made on the football field, but his great work ethics. Many times as coaches, obviously we're behind, we'll be at practice and waiting on the kids and all to you know, get off to a safe start home and kind of game plan and talk about responsibility for the weekend. And that was Rick, always out to practice with a football, just zipping it, straight up in the air, throwing the ball to himself, 30, 40 yards. Great velocity, great spiral on his football. So I said to myself then, I said, by God, that kid going to be something one day, and he's going to be a heck of a leader for somebody.
April 1st of 2005, Ricky, we're fixed to go to spring practice in about a month. And Ricky goes to comes to school that day, and everybody forgot it was April Fool's, I think, except Ricky. But he tells everybody in the school, from the athletic director to the principal to the assistant principals to all the coaches, that he's leaving Douglas County High School. And he was going to go somewhere else. I forgot where it was. I know it wasn't Lithia or Alexander, Chapel Hill. We didn't beat them too bad. I knew he wasn't going to go there. But anyway, Ricky had everybody fooled. He had girls crying in the school, little teenage girls. They were crying because they thought Ricky was going to leave the school. Of course, I was crying more than anybody else because I was fixing to retire and I wanted to go out on a good note. Well, Ricky let this go on practically the whole day, and finally, I can't remember if I had to call Thomas. Anyway, I found out. Did I call you, Thomas? I called Thomas. I said, Thomas. He said, Ricky's just pulling an April Fool's joke on all of y'all.
I was watching him warm up, and, you know, nothing special stood out, not during, you know, basic layups and warm-ups. Then the game started, and I don't know if you've ever been on a summer day early in the morning at a pond or maybe late in the evening, sunset, when you've seen these bugs that scoot all over the water top like a water bug. When the time the opening tap went up, that's what he was. He was like a water bug all over the place. I mean, perpetual energy, and I've never told you this, but it was at that moment I knew you were going in the military. I did, and I'll tell you why. I left that game knowing, well, I'm gonna discipline him. I'm gonna get that technique because I'm a stickler for discipline on technique. So flash forward to his junior year. I forget who we were playing at home, but and everybody in the military will appreciate this. But I started yelling at him from the sideline. You're going AWOL on me. AWOL. Who was it? It was Lithia Springs, and he didn't like that too much. And for those of you who don't know what AWOL means, it's away without leave. And in the military, unless you've got the commanding officer's permission to be somewhere, you don't go somewhere without their knowing about it. And but thank God, again, he was just trying to be a playmaker, and that's what Ricky is. He's a playmaker, and thank God I didn't get that out of his system, because I mean, he hit 9 threes against Chapel Hill to help us win the second straight region championship. He hit the buzzer beater against Villarica, put us in overtime, hit the free throw. He's done so many things that there's just no way that you take a playmaker's ability out of him.
As an educator, seeing a young man like Ricky grow up and succeed as he did reminds me each day of why we entered this profession. I want to thank you, Ricky, and I wish you continued success.
Now, I could share with you some memories about how I beat him in a foot race one time. He was in the eighth grade, but anyway, I can also tell you about the times that I almost soiled myself when he would come up behind me and sound like a Rottweiler, you know, woo! All right. Or I could tell you about the time that I invited him to come and speak to my American government class for about a half hour, and he ended up spending an hour and a half in there shaking hands. And at first, the kids were like, who's Ricky Dobbs? And by the end, they're like, I don't know who he is, but I want his autograph. Yeah.
He always made me nervous. Everybody knows he's a magnet. And you go to a tournament, and you see all these coaches talking to Ricky, and Ricky talking to them, and you're like, man, Ricky's gone. But but he always stayed with us, and as all of the kids, they stayed with us. And, you know, we were able to go very far, and we were able to win a lot of tournaments. I remember a lot of times we went to places and no one knew us, and when we left, everyone knew us.
One thing as coaches that we realized and knew on for a long time, when it's come to throwing a football and getting that ball down the field with accuracy and what have you, Ricky Dobbs could knock a fly off a butterfly.
This financial advisor is being accused of committing one of the largest investment frauds in the history of the United States.
I guess we're not going to Aspen. That's fine. You see, I like tennis balls. He likes insider trading. So he's going to jail and I'm going to a shelter. And no, they're not the same thing. Shelters are for good pets that want to be adopted. Jails are for criminals. I done nothing. Uh-oh. Okay, I stole a cheeseburger once. How my dog?
Okay, they didn't know we were going to do this, I don't believe, but this is our family moment, and Ricky asked that we summon these folks up. Come on, you guys, come on up, because I'm going to interview you all, and it's not going to be real long or lengthy, but it's going to be informative. Okay, this is his dad, Ricky Sr.
How you doing?
Okay, and this is mom, Barbara Bootsy.
Good evening.
And this is his aunt, Anita. Mm-hmm.
Hello.
And this is his uncle, Thomas.
Yes.
All right. The reason why we wanted to do this family moment is we wanted to sort of get an insight into Ricky as a young boy growing up, young man. Well, young boy, really, before he became a young man. But as a child. And I'm going to, whoever I point the mic to, that's who I want to answer, okay? Okay. How was he an obedient child?
Yes, he was adorable. He was. Everybody loved him. I would take him places, parks, girls in the park, let me hold that baby. So he was a precious young man.
Okay, you're not just saying that because you're in front of all these people. I really believe that that's genuine. And mom, I want to ask you, you've got a picture out there of him basically out of the womb. And describe that picture and how he's holding his hand.
Well, first of all, I want everybody to know that when they give me that baby, he was a special baby. I looked at him and I said, he's special. And he's proven that to me today. And when you look at that picture out there, it looked like he come out ready to throw a ball. You know, so that's the story behind that.
Okay, and now Anita and Thomas, I know you all have been quite influential in his life. Can you think of any moment that he was in your life that you thought was special and that you knew, may have known he was destined for a good thing?
Only the fact that he's always, like you said, an obedient child, and no matter what we asked him to do, he did it. Being in the house with my other two daughters, they may want to stray and say, I'm not going to wash the dishes, or I'm not going to fold up the clothes or turn my cell phone in at 10 o'clock. But Ricky always did what he was supposed to do. He would always get behind them and let them know that's what they're supposed to do, is what we tell them to do. And he was always the leader. He led them, and he always told them when they were right, when they're wrong, and he still does to this day. If they get out of line, he straightens them out.
All right. That's didn't know you had those skills, Ricky. And Uncle Thomas, what are some of your special and precious moments that you remember with Ricky as he was growing up?
Well, just over the years, really every day, because I didn't have a son, so Rick was like my son, is my nephew. I call him my nephew son. But I mean, there were some great times over the past years that when I was coaching him, that were really special. I knew he was gonna be destined for greatness in football when we were playing Beulah Bulldogs in a championship game, and Rick was playing quarterback, and he was also playing outside linebacker. And I forget the kid name at Beulah, but he was a big kid. Rick, they were running a counter trap, and Ricky blitzed from the linebacker position. And that kid came from fullback and hit him in the mouth and knocked the front two teeth loose. And he come over to the sideline just crying, and I looked at his mouth. I said, man, I said, it's blood. I looked at Coach Jermaine. I said, what are we going to do? And I looked at Ricky. I pushed his teeth back in his mouth, pushed his mouthpiece on it, And he went back out there and played that game. And he's still, you know, he's still that tough today. But right now, one of the things that really let me know that Rick is special is his spiritual walk right now. Just about every week, at least one day a week, Rick will call me with a scripture. And we'll talk about the scripture. And most of the times, the scripture that he brings to me is something that I need. So it's just a spiritual walk right now. It's really impressing me.
Well, I've got one. Thank you all. That's just wonderful. Wonderful comments that only you could give. I have one question to ask. Can he sing?
Can Ricky sing?
Can Ricky sing? No.
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 Uh-oh. Okay, he didn't acquire that skill from the Cobbs or the Dobbs, that singing skill. Okay. Well, thank you all very much for sharing those moments with us. We appreciate it. Okay, and now we'd like to hear from Ricky's aunts and uncles from the Cobb side and the Dobb side. If you all would please approach. Where are you all? Aunts and uncles. Oh, here they come. Now these, I know at least two of these folks can sing. I know Miss Lisa, Miss Vicky, and here is an aunt,
Kay.
Kay, Aunt Kay, and we've got an Uncle Larry. Okay, these are aunts and uncles, and you know, sometimes aunts and uncles are kind of like moms and dads. They tend to kind of want to take over a life, you know, of somebody who's a niece or a nephew. They kind of overstep their boundaries a little bit. And this is
Sherman.
Uncle Sherman. Okay, yes, we know Uncle Sherman. So, okay, what I'm going to, each one I'm going to ask probably the same question, okay? What is your most memorable experience or with Ricky?
On Christmas, on Christmas, 1 year, he would call me, well, on Facebook, every day. Today, we see who can tell each other who loves each other first. And if he beat me, he'll say, I beat you today. And if I beat him, I beat him today. But when he was about, what grade was you in? Seventh grade. He used to call me. He said, I want to go to church. And I want to go to church with you. Can you come get me? I said, yes, I'll come get you. Well, most kids for Christmas want, only have one nephew in the world. But most kids want tennis shoes back then. They wanted Nikes. They wanted jogging suits and stuff like that. But I said, Ricky, what do you want me to get you for Christmas? And I had my Bible in the car, and it had my name engraved on the front. He said, that's what I want. I said, you want a Bible? You don't want no tennis shoes? He said, I want a Bible. And that's my most memorable because he can always keep the word. And you know I had to get it for him.
All right, Miss Lisa. Very good. Okay, very good. Uncle Sherman, look
closer. My most memorable moments about Ricky is actually his whole life. I watched him play football, basketball, have fun. You know, we always would go to the parks and Whitewater, Six Flags, stuff like that. And he was always, I'm going to say, obedient. You know, I never had to look for him, chase after him, or do anything like that. You know, what I told the kids to do, they did. And he's a great young man. And I'm very proud of him.
I think I got two of them. One of them is when I first saw his picture with his cap on in the Navy. And it reminded me of my brother, his grandfather. It looks so much like him. You couldn't really hardly tell him apart. And the next one is the fact that I heard him in the locker rooms over at high school, leading the young men in prayer before and after practice. You just can't, I don't know how you find that, but that's something special because you can't teach a kid that.
Let's see, I got so many, but I think my most memorable things is just going to his game, football and basketball games, and always watching him at the end of every game, especially in football, you would just see all the people just gravitate to him. You know, you just stand back and look at all the people. I was like, just look at him. They'd be wanting his autograph. And I was like, God, he's real special. And so that's one. And then going to the basketball games, it's like everybody always waiting on him to come out of the locker room. He'd be the last person to come out the locker room. So it's like you'd be wanting to see him and congratulate him because he done so good in the basketball game, but by the time he come out, everybody gone. Because he the last one. But most of the things, just watching all the people just gravitate to him and see the spirit and all of that. All right.
Well, I have several as well. This is my sister, Vicky. I like to consider myself as one of the favorite aunties. I'm sure he has many. But my most memorable moment for Ricky is when we got ready to get the jerseys or the uniform, the jerseys with number 3 on the back to support him for all of his football games. And next thing I know, just about everybody that supported Douglas County started representing whoever they came to the games to support. So just that character in Ricky to drive and start that type of thing, it just made me feel good and proud to be his auntie.
And I'm Linda, as they call me Bebe. I'm going to be the auntie and the cousin and whatever you want me to be, Ricky. Just don't forget me. Remember I told you? Okay. But my most thing about Ricky, his mom, Boosie, we've been real close, the whole family. But she brought that baby home. One of the beautifulest boy. I said, this is a pretty boy baby. And I used to go get him, and I would keep him with me. And he came to the house, spent the night, and I said, well, let's put our shoes on. Let's go, baby. He had them on. I said, baby, you got him on the wrong feet. Do you know he was at 1 year old, switched them shoes, and put them on right. So that was like, oh, man, he understood what I was saying. But right then and there, I knew Ricky was going to be somebody. And Ricky, keep God first in your life, and all the others will be added.
Hallelujah. All right. Thank you, family. Thank you so much, those aunts and uncles.
I love you. I love you. I love you more today because of care for Ricky in such a special way. I love you, Ricky. I love you. Don't ever forget about baby. When you make it up there, all I want is a house.
All right. I told you they could sing. And now I believe we will hear from the songbird of the South again, Miss Dottie Peoples. Miss Dottie Peoples has a place called Dottie's Place in the Union Station Mall that used to be Shannon Mall. We were out there yesterday, and I mean, it's just awesome. She had praises in the mall yesterday, and I mean, it was packed. Really good singing, local singing, and you didn't tell me to say all that, but I was trying to say something to give you a chance to approach since she refused to sit at the head table, okay?
Okay, here you go. This time I'll say good evening to everyone. And I know where we are, but let the church say amen.
Amen.
Say amen again.
Amen.
Say amen one more time.
Amen.
And to Ricky, I'm just honored and glad to be with you on this special occasion. But you know, when Miss Redwine called you 50 times, you cannot say no. I'm just glad to be here because I saw so many friends and Mitch from Coco Brother Live. Y'all done heard me on there doing his program. I was just glad to see everyone. But we got this one song. If you just turn up just a little bit, the track. He says,
He may not come when you want him, baby. Whatever you're going through, he's always going to be on time. I want y'all just get on your feet and rock with me for just a minute. Y'all fans.
James Grillo, and my city TV is streaming 24/7.
So my uncle calls and he says he's dizzy and he's losing his balance. I'm like, Unc, you want me to take you to a doctor? He's like, no, I'm gonna look up the symptoms. I said, your symptoms are you're dizzy and you're losing your balance. So he said, I can't get on the internet because my arm is numb. I said, well, use your good arm and dial 911.
Stroke's no joke. If you or someone you love is showing symptoms of stroke, don't wait because it might be too late. Dial 911. Time lost is brain lost.
Okay, this is about a building in our community that's very special. After over 3 years of work and research, the Beulah Grove Masonic Lodge and Pleasant Grove Colored School was placed on the National Register of Historic Places on February 7th, of this year. Located off Fairburn Road on Lower River Road, it is owned by Pleasant Grove Baptist Church. The building is rare. It is over 100 years old and it's only two of its kind still remaining in the state of Georgia and probably in the country, especially in the South. The Masons met upstairs in this building and the little black children had school downstairs. This was around 1890 and early 1900s.
We learned that a freed slave, Jack Smith, donated the land to the church, Pleasant Grove Baptist Church, in 1889 for the purpose of having a church, a cemetery, a lodge, and a school.
And during the late 90s and the early 1920s, your black Masons and your preachers were the community's leaders. And they were role models. They They were responsible for the physical and mental welfare of their African-American brethren. The original stewards and deacons of the property were these family names, and I know a lot of you are probably related to some of these people. They were the Cochrans, the Duncans, the Bennetts, the Lindleys, among others.
And according to Deacon Albert Lindley of the Pleasant Grove Baptist Church, Ricky, some of your ancestors played a role in building the school and lodge. Della Cochran of the Cochran family, previously mentioned, married Mose Lindley, one of the original church deacons. Deacon Lindley said Della's sister Julia was your great, great, great grandmother.
And he then said that you were supposed to take up the rest of this family history from your grandfather, Lewis Cobb Sr., because he really didn't know the rest of it, okay? So you got to get with your granddaddy and find out the rest of this legacy. Our restoration effort began on the building about 3 weeks ago. It was defaced and by some vandals, and it was in the news, so we decided, since it was placed on the register in February, that we needed to speed up our restoration efforts so that we could secure it and protect it. It's been there all these 100 years, and then at the moment it's placed on the register, it gets vandalized, okay? Mike, you know, this restoration effort has brought about a lot of different people who have different interests.
It's brought our Douglas County community together, many groups that not too many decades ago would have been segregated. But because of the overall pride in this building, that this one church thought enough to preserve it all these years, these various communities have met on Saturdays to work on its restoration together.
Just last week, thanks to Tim Williams and the Greystone Power Corporation, we were able to cut down some trees around the building. So we want to thank them for that. The wood that we cut down will be recycled at the sawmill to the fellow who is actually orchestrating this effort. And he has the ability to replicate and duplicate every single plank in that building to its original structure. So we were fortunate to get him, because nobody's being paid for this. So it's all volunteer.
And that's an important point, because you can't go to our building supply companies, Lowe's and Home Depot, even though they're supporting us. You can't go and buy the materials that are in this original structure. Our website will be up and running within a few weeks. The bank account is in the name of the Beulah Restoration. Our completion date is scheduled for May of next year. Our plans are for the church to continue to use this as a fellowship hall, and we will use it as a community center for tutoring and small meetings. It will from time to time be used as a museum. And one of the things that I personally would love to see is our young people holding class in that classroom to connect back to our past history.
We are not eligible for grants because our committee is only temporary and the building is owned by a church. We must depend on the contributions for private citizens like all of you, private corporations, and of course, from all of our government entities and our elected officials. That includes you, Congressman Scott, State Representative Bill Henbury, Mayor Mickey Thompson, and you too, Commissioner Mulcair, representing the county.
Absolutely.
Okay, so all right. They heard, okay, witnesses, they know we need to preserve this building. Now, Ricky, when you and your friends and your national news media buddies, where is Steve Yonda of the Washington Post? Stand, Steve, I don't know where you are, but stand up. Oh, there he is. Steve is doing a documentary on Ricky, and he's been traveling with us, and he's been trying to get a feel for our community. So as I was saying, that when they are going around trying to get a feel, Ricky, you need to take them to visit your historic legacy. This is our gift to you, Ricky. Turn around and look at it. Okay, it's an unlikely gift, but I believe the Navy would approve of it, okay? And anything else you'd like to say, Mike?
Well, we'd just like to present the Beulah Grove Lodge 372, free and accepted York Wright Masons in the Pleasant Grove School right here on the board here. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Mike has been with the The committee for almost 4 years now. I chaired it about 4 years ago. It took us about 3 years to do all of the research, and he's been on board all this long time, and now we're into our restoration mode. So I want to thank you, Commissioner Mulcair, for all your work.
Well, it's been my pleasure, and I also extend my thanks on behalf of Peggy, my wife. She's pulled a few days out there as well.
She certainly has. I also would like to recognize a CBS college crew that also is doing a documentary on Ricky. And we have a crew here from the CBS College News, and we want to thank you guys for coming out and spending this time with us. And you can give my regards to Mr. Berkeley. Okay? All right. Now, at this point in our program, we would like to recognize our elected officials and their tribute to Ricky. We're going to start with the city of Douglasville, and I believe we're going to start with a taped message from Councilman Sam Davis, who represents this district, who grew up in this area, and who is related to Ricky. So at this time, we'll play that clip from him, from Councilman Davis. He was unable to be with us today. I understand that he is in Washington, D.C.
Good afternoon. My name is LaShawn Burdanley, and it is such an awesome pleasure to be here with my colleague.
And my name is Councilman Davis, Sam Davis.
Councilman Davis, isn't it awesome to be here to give this tribute to Ricky Dobbs and our community and our friends on this evening?
Yes, Ricky, I just want to say thank you for all your accomplishments, and thank you again for coming back for this tribute. And I'm sorry that I will not be able to make the tribute, but you have my prayers and my heart.
Now, Councilman Davis, where are you going?
I'm doing work in Washington next week. And Ricky, as soon as you get back on Monday afternoon, Justin, say hello. We all going out for dinner.
All right. Congratulations again, Ricky. Councilman Davis, you be careful and have a safe trip. I'll see you when you get back.
I will. And to everybody out there in the audience, hello, Ricky. We love you. And welcome back. Thank you.
We love you.
All right. And the young lady conducting that interview is our own Councilwoman LaShawn Burdanley, who is with us. And she is going to present the proclamation on behalf of the city of Douglasville.
You know, I'd say little Ricky, we love you so much. Just want to say thank you for being so humble and for all of the entertainment and like get-togethers that you had for the young people. I'm so proud of you for doing service, because they could not get in unless they brought 2 cans to donate to the food bank. So I'm proud of you. Being the city councilwoman for this district, I do not represent this district alone. But I represent with the other colleagues who definitely love little Ricky, if I may. And to all your family, the Cobbs and the Dobbs and Barbara, Bootsy Cobb, Thomas, Anita, Lisa, all of you, we love you, Ms. Cobb, Mr. Cobb. We'd like to read this proclamation along with Mayor Pro Tem John Shildroff, Councilman Dennis McClain. Whereas today, the Douglas County community recognizes and honors a young man who has attracted nationwide attention due to his leadership, abilities, athletic skills, and his exemplary performance in the classroom and on the football field. And whereas the city of Douglasville is proud today to celebrate with Clarence Ricky Dobbs, a special occasion when many friends and family members have gathered at Alice Minor Hawthorne Center in the city's Jesse Davis Park to highlight some of the events in his life and to look ahead at his very promising future. And whereas Ricky Dobbs grew up in Douglasville, graduated from Douglas County High School, and was a frequent participant in activities in the cities, Davis Park and Hunter Park, and at the local Boys and Girls Club, and
whereas Ricky Dobbs accepted an appointment to the United States Naval Academy, where he has become recognized by classmates and football teammates and by the Naval Academy faculty members for his leadership, his accomplishments, and his devotion to his family in Douglasville, his friends here and in Annapolis, and in his nation, which he has chosen to serve. And whereas Ricky Dobbs' performance on the football field throughout the 2009 season resulted in him breaking the all-time record in college football history for the most rushing touchdowns. Scored in a single season, in him being selected the most valuable player in the 2009 Texas Bowl, and in leading his Navy team in winning the 2009 Commander-in-Chief's Trophy, and in record-breaking winning season. And
whereas with his performance in the classroom and on the field at Douglas County High School, as well as with his warm personality and strong character traits, all resulting in him being called the mayor, who can question his intention someday to being called Mr. President on the national basis? Now, therefore, I, Mickey Thompson, Mayor of the City of Douglasville, do hereby congratulate Ricky Dobbs for his many accomplishments in the past and in this community and at the Naval Academy. I do hereby call attention to the tremendous future which I believe lies ahead for this outstanding young man. I do hereby proclaim Sunday, June the 13th of 2010, to be Clarence Ricky Thomas Day in the City of Douglasville. So proclaimed the 13th day of June of 2010. Signed, Mayor Mickey Thompson.
You got the key.
I got the key.
Well, thank you, Gwen. It's certainly an honor for me to be here today to recognize such a wonderful young man. You know, Ricky came by City Hall, I guess it was a couple of months ago now. In January, it's been longer than I thought. And he stopped by to see all of us and was so patient. And got his picture made with all of us. And, you know, I kind of thought that was the end of it. You know, when you think about government, the wheels of government typically work pretty slow, you know. We'll talk about things and then we'll run them before the city council. And it takes a while for things to happen. So I thought that was the end of it. Now, keep in mind, Ricky says he's going to be president. And I believe that. And so he had his picture made with all of us. As I said, he had been very patient. Well, that wasn't the end of it. This just shows you how well he can organize things and how great a president he will be. So by the time we finished with those pictures and we talked a few minutes, The pictures came back. They were printed in color, just like they'd been produced in a lab. Now, I don't know how he made that happen. It takes me weeks to get things to happen in the city of Douglasville, but he comes to town, takes pictures with us, he gets the pictures, and then he autographs all the pictures, probably within 30 minutes. So that was a remarkable feat, I can tell you. And, you know, I was, like Coach, I was calculating how old I'll be when Ricky is the president. That's 93 years old. But what I can tell you, Ricky, is door-to-door campaigning always works. It's always worked for me in four elections. So when you run for president, I'll be in a senior home by that time, and I'm going to go door-to-door for you. So just let me know. I love to campaign door-to-door, and I will certainly do that. But, you know, I read in the paper, and someone today said his classmates and others calling the mayor of Douglasville. I think that's a tribute. I was also doing some math. I thought, well, how long is it going to be before he's going to run against me? So I'm safe. You've got a four-year commitment in the military and on and on. But I can tell you, if he ever elects to do that, your city will be honored to have him, and you would have a great mayor if he did that. I wanted to be here today, Ricky, to present something to you, if you wouldn't mind joining me on stage. This is a key to the city. And typically, I tell folks, this is a key to get out of jail, but you're such a fine young man, you'll never need this key. But it reads as follows: presented to Midshipman Ricky Dobbs, our native son who dares to dream big. 2009 NCAA record of single season rushing touchdowns, United States Naval Academy quarterback. Presented to Ricky Dobbs this Sunday, June the 3rd, 2010, by myself, Mickey Thompson.
Thanks.
Congratulations. It's an honor to know you.
Thank you, Mayor Thompson. And now representing the county, once again, Commissioner Mike Mulcair.
Thank you. And on behalf of Chairman Worthen, I appreciate the fact that we're here today. Obviously, I'm a little unprepared to make any kind of protracted statement, so I think y'all probably appreciate that. I'm going to read a proclamation from the Douglas County Board of Commissioners, a proclamation naming June 13th as Ricky Dobbs Day in Douglas County. And I think we maybe have just a few separate items here, different from the city proclamation. Whereas Clarence Ricky Dobbs, a native of Douglasville, Georgia, and 2006 graduate of Douglas County High School, has gone on at this point in his life to represent the city of Douglasville and the county of Douglas with great distinction. And whereas during his years as a Douglas County High School student, he portrayed such commendable attributes that his teachers referred to him as the mayor. And he was the recipient of the Faculty Cup at his commencement ceremony in 2006. And whereas Ricky Dobbs, who has demonstrated outstanding achievements both in academics by being accepted into the United States Naval Academy at Annapolis, and in sports by leading the Navy football team as quarterback, and whereas in 2008 Navy football season, Ricky Dobbs rushed for 498 yards and 8 touchdowns, and Navy was honored at the White House in April of 2009 for winning a 6th straight Commander-in-Chief trophy. Whereas in his role as quarterback for the Navy midshipman in 2009, Ricky broke the single season college football record for the most rushing touchdowns by a quarterback. And whereas in 2009, Ricky finished with an NCAA record of 27 single season rushing touchdowns as was named the game's MVP in the 2009 Texas Bowl. And whereas Ricky has thrown just 4 interceptions in 121 career attempts. Now, I do the math, that's .033, the lowest interception percentage in Naval football history. I'm not finished now. Whereas Ricky has scored 4 or more rushing touchdowns on 4 different occasions during his career, including 3 times this year, no other Navy player has more than 1 career 4 rushing touchdown day. And whereas Ricky Dobbs, in spite of his national exposure and household name recognition, remains close to his parents, Barbara Cobb and Clarence Dobbs, his family, and his community in Douglasville, remembering from him from whence he came and remaining proud of his Douglasville home. Now, therefore, be it proclaimed that June 13th as Ricky Dobbs Day in Douglas County. Signed, Tom Worthen and the County Commission.
Thank you, Commissioner Mulcair. And now we'll hear from the esteemed State Representative Bill Hembree.
Thank you, Gwen. Governor Sonny Perdue could not be here tonight, but he asked me to read this commendation by the governor of the state of Georgia. Whereas Ricky Dobbs is a native of Douglasville, Georgia, and a graduate of Douglas County High School, where he was in 2006 the recipient of the Faculty Cup. And whereas through his outstanding academic and athletic track record, Ricky Dobbs earned acceptance into United States Naval Academy, where he leads the football team as quarterback. And whereas in 2008 season, the midshipman Dobbs rushed for 498 yards and 8 touchdowns, and Navy won its 6th straight Commander-in-Chief's Trophy. In 2009, he broke the single-season college football record for the most rushing touchdowns by a quarterback with 27 and was named most valuable player in the Texas Bowl. And whereas in his college career thus far, midshipman Dobbs has thrown for just 4 interceptions in 121 total attempts, which is the lowest interception rate in Navy football history. He has scored 4 or more rushing touchdowns in a single game on 4 different occasions, while no other Navy player has had more than 1 in such game. And whereas Ricky Dobbs is an outstanding young Georgian who has given great credit to his family, his community, and our state, we are proud of his accomplishments and look forward to witnessing his continued success. Now, therefore, I, Sonny Perdue, governor of the great state of Georgia, do hereby commend Ricky Dobbs for this outstanding accomplishment. I want you to stay here. I have something too. We all know where your success comes from, and it's sitting right there. The Dobbs family and the Cobbs family, God bless you. God bless you, folks. These folks at this table and all you folks here tonight, you've made Ricky what he is and what he can be. And that's a great man that he is and the great man that he will be. And I'll tell you something. There was a fellow, I want to give you some wisdom. Truett Cathy, you've had a Chick-fil-A, right? A guy named Truett Cathy started Chick-fil-A. He once told me, he said, Bill, there's the 3 M's in life. Your master, your mission, and your mate. You know who your master is that right?
Yes, sir.
You know what your mission is that right?
Yes, sir.
Ladies, he's got to find a mate. Not yet. Not yet. Not just yet. You're going to be sailing away to foreign lands and sailing the seas of this great world soon when you get your commission in the United States Naval Academy, and you'll be serving on a ship, I understand. And I don't want you ever, I know you won't, but I don't want you ever to forget this great state of Georgia. So I'm going to give you, I hope you will carry it with you as you travel to these foreign lands, a flag that has flown over this capital of the great state of Georgia, so you will always remember that Georgia is on your mind. God bless you, my friend.
And now we will hear from Congressman David Scott.
Thank you so very much. Good evening, everyone. What a special, special occasion. This is truly God's blessing that has been poured out to us today. I want to thank you, Ms. Gwen Summers Redwine, for inviting me to be a part of this. You know, Ms. Summers Redwine was, remember her from her days, she pioneered with Ted Turner, became one of the first CNN anchors. We're so proud of you, and I'm glad that you invited me. Give her a hand. And I just got to say this. What a special set of parents in Barbara Cobb and Clarence Dobbs. Would you please stand up? Can we give them a round of applause? You know, you got to God bless the child and God bless the mama and daddy that brought the child into the world. You know, as I was sitting there, I listened. Sometimes it's so good when you come near the end of the program because you can learn so much and hear so much. And I kept saying, what is it? And there's one word. When you think of all that's been said by the coaches, by the family, by the politicians, by the friends, by all of us here, and sung so eloquently by Miss Dottie Peoples as she poured out that blessing of song. One word, excellent. That is the word that describes this young man. Excellent. Excellence is God's name. You know, back as we go back, the great Greek philosopher Aristotle was asked the question. He said, Aristotle, what does it take to be excellent? Well, Aristotle said, in order for you to be excellent, you must, first of all, know thyself. Well, not only does this young man, Ricky Dobbs, know himself or know who he is, he knows whose he is. That first and foremost, he's a child of God. Did that come through tonight? He's a child of God. Later on, that question was put to the great Roman general and emperor Marcus Aurelius. They said, Marcus Aurelius, what does it take to be excellent? And Marcus Aurelius said, in order to be excellent, you must first of all discipline yourself. You heard it from the coaches, the discipline. You heard it from the teachers, discipline. The discipline that it took for him, not just to perform on the athletic field, which he did remarkably, as the coaches attributed to. But to discipline as he did that, to have the highest academic standing so that he could qualify to go to the Naval Academy. You not only must be able to play football to go to the Naval Academy, you've got to be smart. The discipline, the focus that he had. And then finally, that question was put to the great Messiah, Jesus Christ. They said, Jesus, what does it take to be excellent? And Jesus said, in order to be excellent, you must first of all sacrifice yourself. This young man epitomizes that sacrifice. And what he was saying was, you must do unto others as you would have them do unto you. You must love your neighbor as yourself. That great commandment is embodied in the life story, the young life story of this young man. Excellent. As the songbirds say, how excellent is God's name. How excellent is Ricky Dodd. Ricky Dobbs, I'd like for you to come on and please join me. I have here to present to you some words that will be place tomorrow night when I get back to Washington on the floor of the Congress of the United States to be voted on to go into the United States Congressional Record of the United States Congress. And so that I don't flub anything, I'm going to reach in here and get my spectacles, which appear to be lost in here, but here they come. This is for Ricky Dobbs Day in Douglas County. It gives me great pleasure as a member of Congress to congratulate and commend the accomplishments of this young man, Clarence Ricky Dobbs, as we gather today here in Douglasville for this well-deserved tribute. I am as proud as all of the people attending of Ricky Dobbs, a Douglasville native son who has done so well, referred to as the mayor by his Douglas County High School teachers, who saw in him at that time what was to come and what is, and awarded him the faculty cup at his commencement ceremony in 2006. The exceptional academic accomplishments made under the tutelage of this local high school faculty enabled Ricky Dobbs to be accepted at the United States Naval Academy at Annapolis. Excellence starts at the local level. As the United States Naval Academy, he led the Navy football team as quarterback with 8 touchdowns in the 2008 Navy football season. And the Navy was honored at the White House with President Barack Obama in April 2009 for winning a 6th straight Commander-in-Chief trophy. As a United States representative in Congress of the 13th Congressional District, I want to acknowledge my earnest support and commendation to Ricky Dobbs and other exceptional young men and women like him, many who do not always get recognition for getting it right. But we today are getting recognition to this young man for getting it right. It is very encouraging to see the results of what happens when loving parents and caring community work together for a common goal. Then we surpass in leaps and bounds. God bless you, Clarence Ricky Dobbs. And as a special treat, tomorrow night, if any of you watch television, let's check us out on C-SPAN when we put this before the Congress of the United States and my words, so that the entire nation will be able to understand what happened here this day, at this time, for this young man in Douglasville. Thank you.
All right. What an honor. All of these accolades this afternoon, and we're not done yet. We would like to play a video clip from President Barack Obama at this time.
Last season was special from the very beginning. In your first game, you gave the Buckeyes a run for their money in front of 105,000 fans. You beat Notre Dame for the second time in 3 years, proving once again that even though your linemen are going up against guys who are 40 or 50 pounds heavier than they are, the midshipmen can still run with the big dogs. Speaking of running, I want to congratulate Ricky Dobbs for setting the NCAA rushing record for touchdowns by a quarterback this season with 27. Where's Ricky? Where is he? The previous record was held by a guy named Tebow, so that's not an easy feat. Now, I also understand Ricky has announced for the presidency in the year 2040. I know people are announcing early these days, but Ricky, that's a bit much. But it does mean that when Navy comes back for the Commander-in-Chief's trophy 30 years from now, you might hear a speech from this guy.
And now I have the honor of introducing to you, it's not a long introduction, I simply Googled this woman and I was just inspired by what I learned about her, and I can understand why she and Ricky are so close. Her name is Command Master Chief Evelyn Vaughn Banks. We welcome you, Master Chief. Come on up. She's just a favorite all-time person here in Douglas County.
Since we're doing presidential today, President John Adams said, if your actions inspire others to dream more, to learn more, to do more, to become more, then you are a leader. My friend, you are a leader. I thank God today. I thank him first for life and for each one of you. Very briefly to the esteemed dignitaries, congressional leaders, community leaders, parents, family, friends, and those behind the scenes that makes things happen. Thank you for having me here today. I have but a few words for you this afternoon about Midshipman First Class Ricky Dobbs. I came to the Naval Academy, and it has been both my personal and my professional pleasure to serve as his command master chief for the last 3 years. And I've just checked out and I'm en route to Navy Sea Systems Command in Washington, D.C. But I would not have missed this opportunity for anything. We joined the Naval Academy at the same time, and I had the task to go down and do inspirational speaking for the football team. Mind you, I didn't even know what a first down was. I didn't have any idea that you don't chunk the ball. Thank you, son. I appreciate it. But what I did know was about winning wars and being ever ready to serve for America's freedoms. And it was my task to make sure they understood the connection between playing the ball and those watching in Iraq and Afghanistan. And I said, we're going to win, and we're going to win, and we're going to win. And they did that for me. As we were in our journeys, I couldn't ever get it right to bless us out. They would say, oh, team on three, or defense on three, and mind you, I messed that up. But as we were coming down to the bowl game, we lost to Hawaii, you know that. And so we couldn't do our three that we always did. So I went to Miss Jimmy Dog. I said, you've given me three Army Navy wins. You've given me two Notre Dame wins. All I want is just one bowl, please. So we're going to do it 3-2-1. And we did that. So if you will join me today, I'm going to get this thing right. You're supposed to say, Ricky Dobbs on three. So when I count to three, I need you on your feet and say, Ricky Dobbs. Now help me to get this right. Ricky Dobbs on three. 1, 2, 3.
Thank you, Command Chief. She's just like family, you guys. She is family to the Dobbs and the Cause. I've been hearing about her ever since we started this project, and I know why. I know why. Thank you so much. Now I'd like to introduce to you all Commander Keith Hoskins. He's another one that I understand why Ricky admires him so much. I Googled you too, Commander Hoskins. I understand, I read on the internet that somebody was picking you up and they described you as a real handsome man in uniform. That was how they were supposed to recognize you to pick you up, okay? So anyway, we'll hear from Commander Hoskins at this time.
How's everybody doing today? Excellent. I tell you what, it's hard going after so many great speakers. I flew in this morning. I wouldn't miss this for the world for Ricky. And I tell you what, I think I want to live in Douglasville if I get this kind of support. I need to talk to a real estate agent sometime soon. But, as I stand up here in uniform, I'm the last speaker. I'm between you and, getting out the doors and going on with your day. So I promise I'm going to be brief. But I just want to say that on behalf of Vice Admiral Fowler, who is the superintendent of the United States Naval Academy, thank you very much for inviting me. Thank you for recognizing Ricky Dobbs. And obviously, thank you very much for being the village that has brought him up the way that he is and brought him to us at the United States Naval Academy. I just want to tell you real quick about the mission of the United States Naval Academy. Obviously, what we do is we graduate leaders. We graduate leaders into the Naval Service. We graduate leaders into the United States Marine Corps. And in order to do that, we have to focus on three mission areas. That's the moral, the mental, and the physical mission, okay? That moral mission is very, very important because that's that, the personal integrity and the honor that we imbue in all of our midshipmen, okay? And also the mental piece, obviously the academics. You got to be smart. Everybody that graduates from the United States Naval Academy gets a Bachelor's of Science, even if you major in history. Very challenging courses. And then the physical aspect, we expect all of our midshipmen to be physical specimens. We want them to be in great shape. And obviously, Ricky Dobbs extends that on the football field every single Saturday in the fall and wows this nation with his outstanding performance. So he's definitely exceeding in that mission area. Also, something at the United States Naval Academy is we have these things called the seven attributes of a midshipman. Everything that we do from in the classroom to the physical side to doing community service, whatever it is, we have seven things that we intertwine with all of their training. Selflessness, inspirational, proficient, innovative, okay, adaptive, articulate, and professional. I can tell you right now that he is the epitome of every single one of those attributes that we have at the United States Naval Academy. You know, every day that I get to interact with Ricky, through his actions, through his words, I mean, I think about the attributes. I think about our mission. He underscores it every single day, every second, every minute. Every time he interacts with somebody, he underscores every single one of those attributes. He is a great young American. But if I were to think about two of those seven attributes that kind of ooze out of his body just nonstop, I would have to say it's inspirational and selflessness. Because everybody that Ricky comes in contact with, as we've discussed here already, he inspires people. I am a senior by 22 years. Okay, I will potentially lead him someday in the fleet. But every time I have contact with this young man, I am inspired by his words, his actions, his faith, and his commitment. Also, I think of, again, selflessness. He is selfless in the way that a lot of people can't really understand. He puts God before country. He's tied in with his family. He's tied in with the institution, the Naval Academy, his company mates, which are about 160 strong. He's tied in with his football players, which is about 120 strong. It's always about the team. It's always about the bigger purpose. It's always about God's plan first before himself. That, to me, is the ingredients of a great leader. And in closing, I just want to say I got one more year with Ricky Dobbs, the senior year next year. I'm going to put you on the spot here. We've been talking about all the records, talking about all the great things that he did when he was here and, you know, playing Little League football, basketball, and growing up in a high school and doing great things, great proclamations that we're getting here today. That ain't nothing. You have not seen the success that this young man has. It's still going to continue. It's still going to grow. He's still going to wow you every single day. He's going to be one of the best leaders that this United States Naval Service has ever seen. I promise you that. You know, before I came up here, Ricky told me, make sure you talk about the double up. I'm going to tell you what the double up is. January 31st is our birthday. We share it. His family surprised him, came into town, we had a party. He turned 22, I turned 44, so we share the same birthday. And I tell you what better person to share my birthday with than Ricky Dobbs, because you'll forever have me as a mentor. You'll forever have me as somebody that will mentor you and lead you and keep you in the straight line to continue success so that you can be the best of the best, and you will be, I promise. God bless you, and God bless Ricky.
Thank you, Commander Hoskins. And now we will hear from Ricky Dobbs himself.
Well, first, I want to thank everybody for coming tonight. I want to say thank you to two wonderful parents. I couldn't ask for two better parents in the world. And then two outside parents, that's what I call outside parents, because they are my aunt and uncle, but they act like a mother and father to me too. And y'all are wonderful, not because of the things that you do, but for the love that you share, because I took that from y'all. And also, in relation to y'all, I want to give thanks to my grandmama and my granddaddy, and my grandma Hazel, because without y'all, we wouldn't have them. And also Miss Betty. So I appreciate you all. And to all my coaches, all the family members here that I have today, who helped shape and mold me into the man that you see today, I thank you for all that you have done and all that you will continue to do. My godmother, I thank you, Shelly, for all that you've done. And then to the great city of Douglasville, and all the people in it, because you know, I'm a firm believer in the saying that it takes a village to raise a child, and Douglasville raised me. That's why I take so much pride in where I'm from. The love and the support that I felt all while I was growing up from this community is second to none. And then I also want to thank the mayor, Mr. Mickey Thompson, and all of your officials. And first, you know, it wasn't me who gave me the nickname, and you know, I don't mean to step on your toes or nothing like that. But I thank you all for getting this event together. I am so humble and just blessed to be in this opportunity, to be in this position, to receive this these prestigious awards and proclamations and all that stuff. But most importantly, I want to thank God. For without God, none of this would be possible. And I want to thank his son, Jesus Christ, who gave his life on the cross and he came back, that we may have life and live it more abundantly. And then, I guess, since we're on the subject, speaking of the cross, in the book of Matthew, chapter 16, verses 24 and 25, Jesus says, "If anyone will come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life will find it. Loses his life for me will find it." So, and when I look back at that, those two scriptures, and what does it mean to take up one's cross is the question. And what I understand it to be is finding your purpose in life according to God's will. Jesus took up his cross on a daily basis for the 33 years that he was here on earth. And by doing that, he died for our sins. That was his purpose according to God's plan. So that we may find out what our purpose in life is. So looking at that, I think, you know, how can we find our purpose in life? And it says it in that scripture. You must first deny yourself. And you deny yourself so that you can find your way and find out what your purpose is according to God's plan. And this process is a hard process. It's not easy. And this process is also that of being a Christian, which is not an easy walk. And one day in the future, in this topic that I've been studying on and looking so much at, the name of it would be The Walk of a Champion. And I get that name because, I mean, I came up with that because as competitive I am in sports and all of that stuff, I think of, you know, spirituality as, my religion and faith as sports, like in a sports sense. So I look at it like in the NBA draft, NFL draft, you always want the best person on your team. Like the Cleveland Cavaliers, they got LeBron James. He was the best basketball player at that time. So in this walk, my first round draft choice is Jesus Christ. And by signing him on my team, that was when I accepted him in my life as my personal Lord and Savior. And this walk of a champion is titled that because with him, he's the champion. And if he's on your team, the devil is going to be after you. And so I look at that, and a lot of the things, I'm going to tell you a quick story. I picked up a guitar probably about a month ago. And my roommate bought him a guitar, and I was playing around with it. And then it kind of led me, and I wrote a song. And now, since my family already put me on blast as far as I can't sing, but that's all that all goes into the song, because the song is titled Freedom. Because when I sing it and play it, I don't care what nobody thinks, because I'm free. And this song is titled Freedom, and, you know, I wrote it, but, you know, my Uncle Thomas, he helped me come up with the words a little bit. He, you know, inspired me, and he was basically telling my story. And what it is, and my story pretty much is that of a champion, a walk of a champion. And by, and, you know, some of the words, I'm going to talk the words to you. And it's so many people around, but lonely I find myself, searching for a peace of mind where somebody helped me find freedom. And with that is, some time to time when you walk in this Christian walk and trying to stray and go against the way of the world, you're going to feel lonely a lot of the time because, I mean, you're going the opposite way of the world. A lot, and I always wonder, like, you know, a lot of times, why am I so lonely? Because it's like I'm always the one who gives people, who give people advice, people come to and talk to, but then I turn around and be like, well, who can I talk to? But, you know, as stubborn as I was at times, and, you know, I felt like, you know, I always knew that I could talk to God, but I felt like I still needed somebody else. But then this song and thinking about this walk of a champion, I really don't need nobody else. And so I look at all of that stuff, and then I also want to talk about how it's, all of this right here today is bigger than me. Because even though I am here on this podium and receiving all of this stuff, it is way bigger than me. It's God's plan. And, you know, one of my things is just about that freedom part and just feeling lonely. I thrive off of people. Like every day in high school, like a lot of people wonder why I was the way I was. It's because I depend on people to fuel me. And it's like there's nothing more encouraging and breathtaking for me than to brighten someone else's day. If a day goes by and I don't brighten someone's day, I feel like I failed in that day. So I look at that and just the whole picture of it being bigger than me. And then you just look around in this room, people who I haven't seen in a while, some people who are my family and I never met before, but they came to come and support. This is not no mistake. God put all of this stuff up here, and I'm just excited to be a part of his plan. And he's using me, and I'm going to let him use me in every way possible. And then I talk about family. You know, my family on the Cobb side, the Dobbs side, the Johnson, Davis. I can go on for days about the family because it's the whole city of Douglasville, Villa Rica, everywhere. But really, and essentially, it's God's family. So I think about family, and then I think about all the stuff that my uncle, Lewis Cobb Jr., he taught me. The great man that he was, you know, and for me, it was a detrimental blow because I wasn't able to attend his funeral. And the last time that I saw him before he passed was the summertime when I was at home before I went to the Naval Academy. But with him, you know, he instilled a lot in me, and everything that he was, everything that all of my family members are, everything that Douglasville is coming out through me. And I am just, you know, blessed to be this person, this beacon of light on God's side, to be able to shine and draw people closer to God because of the way he's shining through me. And that's what Boopy, my Uncle Boopy, taught me. And this is the last story. And that I'm going to tell about this ring that my Uncle Boopy, he gave me. And it was that summer before he died, before the summer of 2007. No, I take that back. He gave it to me the summer of 2006, before I went off to school. And I ended up losing the inside of it. And the inside was a diamond with a black onyx with a diamond in the middle. And when he gave me this ring, he gave me a couple of things on that day. He gave me the plans to a house that he wanted to build for, like, the family, because he wanted to, like, if anybody got sick, he wanted people to be able to come live with him. But he ended up being the one to get sick, so he entrusted me with the plans to that house, so he wanted me to build it. And he told me, he was like, if you don't stay in it, just build it and sell it. And he said, but if you stay in it, just put up a picture of me in the house. That's all I ask. I said, man, that ain't, you know, I got the plans to my house. I already know what kind of house I'm going to have, and everything's laid out. And then when he gave me this ring, though, he explained it like this. There's some little rhinestone things on the outside of the ring. He said those represent the riches of life. And then the black onyx in the ring represents the darkness of the world. And then there's a gold crest around the diamond. He said the gold crest, it symbolizes God's protecting hands around me. And then he said he wanted me to be the diamond shining through the darkness of the world. And so what I got from that day, I was all wrong, because I took it from, in a literal sense right there. I was like, okay, he want Ricky to be successful in everything he do. So I was like, okay, when I go to college, I'm going to go over here and play ball. I got to shine, because Boopy said shine. I got to shine in everything that I do. And it wasn't until my plebe year, which is my freshman year at the academy, the second semester, we was having gospel choir practice. And that gospel choir practice lasted probably like an hour and a half, but it was only like 5 minutes of singing. And the rest of it was just worship and singing and praying. And it wasn't until then when I really thought about and understood what Boopy meant for this ring. And I sat around and I was thinking about the ring itself and the part that I had lost, the diamond, and where did the diamond get its shine from? And that goes back to this freedom part. Where am I going to get my shine from? How am I going to find my freedom? So I thought, and I was like, okay, let me see. Look at the ring. The diamond itself has a shine to it, but the light can go straight through the diamond. And then the gold crest is the asset to that diamond to help, because when the sun comes in and it goes through the diamond, it reflects back off of the gold crest. So the diamond gets its shine from the gold crest. Then I was like, okay, the gold crest, what did he say? Boopy said the gold crest was God's hands protecting me. So I was like, okay. What he really meant for me to do was keep my relationship right with God. Therefore, God's light can shine through me, and I will be a beacon of light for God's army. And that's why I will never get this ring filled again, because if I get it filled, it just becomes a ring again. But now, when people see the hole in this ring, they, you lost that. You know you're missing it. I was like, yeah, I know it. I can tell the story now. So, and that story alone, never know, it could bring somebody to Christ, because they could be lost and wondering where is their place in the world. So that's why I'm going to do it. And then in closing, it's... I don't even know how to even express how I feel today. It's just overwhelmed. I'm like overflowing. And God said he will bless me in so many ways I won't have room to receive him. And I really don't have room to receive this. So that's why, in many different ways, when he say that, I take it as he blessed one person so much, it overflows and somebody else get a blessing. So in this room, I know everybody's going to be blessed because of the reason that you're here today. You thought you came for a proclamation for Ricky Dobbs Day, but I think it's a greater calling to this. And you may not see it right now, and it may not happen when you want it, like Miss Dottie People said, but it's going to be right there on time. And before I go, I just want to pray for everybody. So I ask that everybody bow your heads. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I come to you right now, Lord. Humbly bow before your feet, Lord, asking you to lead, guide, and direct us on the path that you want us to be on, Lord. I pray that you make your name and your presence known and felt in every single heart in this room, Lord. I pray that you also instill in us a will and a desire to strive to seek your face, seek first the kingdom and its glory. And Lord, I pray that you allow us to understand that, all things, both good and bad, they all happen for the good of those who love you and are called according to your purpose. And I pray that we understand that in this walk of a champion, because we are all champions in here, because we are your children, I pray that you just keep us encouraged, allow us to not lean on our own understanding, but on that of yours. And I pray that you also allow us to reach out to each other, because we cannot do this alone. This walk is not meant to be walked alone. And I pray that everybody understands that. I pray that you continue to reveal it to me so I can understand it more and more every day. And as everyone departs from here, I pray that you bless them, safe travels, and you just continue to just be in their lives and a constant reminder in whatever way you know how, the best way that you know how for each and every individual person here today, Lord. I pray for blessings and just continued success in life and the things that we do. In Jesus Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Amen, everybody. Thank you so much, Ricky. You are indeed an inspiration. It's hard for me to understand how someone so young can evoke those kinds of deep feelings. At this time, we have a special presentation of the Patriarch presented by Ricky's mom, Barbara Bootsy. After Bootsy, we will have the singing of God Bless America, and we will have the retiring of colors. Thank you.
My heart is filled with joy today. I want to thank God for, first of all, being able to be here myself, for it's truly a blessing to be able to just be here and stand and see my son's accomplishments. And I'm not good at talking, but there's one thing that I do want to do. I'm not sure if they left yet, but I did birth two people. Rick is not my only child. I have a daughter, TC, Kalari Cobb. Everybody know her as TC. I would like for you to come stand right here, please. Her husband, Philip Brown. And Ricky has three other siblings. Are they still in the building? Oh, okay. Devin Dobbs. Is all y'all still here? I want you to come up with me. Gabriel Dobbs and Alexa Dobbs. Just stand right there. I want to call his father up with me, also, Clarence Ricky Dobbs Sr. And I also like to call, which I call him my hero, my brother Thomas Cobb, and his wife Anita Cobb. I'd like for them to come stand with me, please. I'm going to have to tell you about these two. This is my hero. This is my brother. I'm older than everybody. But my brother loved me enough to love my son, to step in and help me with him. And I want to commend him for the job that he did, because he did a well good job. And Nita, his wife, Nita Johnson Cobb, she treated him just like he is. She, when I first had him, you know, people actually fought over Ricky when he was a baby. I had to share him with a lot of people. But I'm going to keep it short and sweet because everybody, I just love everybody. I want to thank all of y'all for your love and support and caring enough to come and take time to share this event with me and my family and for my son, Ricky. Rick, I want you to stand. There are 12 quality traits, all of which you possess as they relate to your unwavering devotion towards Christ, self, family, others, and your country. For this, I, your mother, Barbara Dobbs Cobb, present you with the banner of patriotism, the patriot. Thank you.
My first week home was great. We had a party, small party.
2 o'clock in the morning, they were waiting for me.
My niece was waiting for me at the airport with a sign and balloons.
There was a huge sign across my front house, and it said, "Welcome home, Megan."
They lift me up on their shoulders,
First week back, people just said thank you. They just said thank you.
A new generation of veterans is coming home. Make a difference for them at welcomebackveterans.org.
We're ready for you, Miss Shakoria. Shakoria is a 12-year-old middle school student at Factory Shoals Middle School, and she is going to sing and send us off with God Bless America.
Good afternoon, everyone. I am Shakoria Calhoun, and I am honored and inspired by being here. Ricky, you are a great role model, and I hope to be honored in this magnitude one day too. My family and I wish you continued success, and may God bless you in America. God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night. We'll fly from above, from the mountains to the prairies to the oceans. Why, with foam, God bless America, my home, sweet home. God bless America, my home, sweet home. God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night. We'll fly from above, from the mountains to the prairies to the oceans. Why, with foam, God bless America, my home, sweet home. God bless America, my